Hi guys, this is Ernie from Borrowed Land Farm, and today I want to go through a pretty quick introduction to the biology of mushrooms for mushroom cultivators. I think this is, if I was going to give anybody just starting out advice on where to start, it would be this. Learn the biology of mushrooms, understand the thing you're trying to grow rather than trying to find a formula for how to grow it. Once you understand the biology of mushrooms, then you can figure it out on your own. And somebody else's formula may not work great for you anyway. So understanding what the mushrooms really want allows you to figure it out on your own. So I'm from Borrowed Land Farm. We are a farm in North Carolina that specializes in spawn and commercial fruiting block production. Our website's borrowedlandfarm.com. All right, let's get going. First thing you need to know is that fungi are living organisms. They are perfectly adapted to the environment that they came from. It doesn't mean that they are going to be perfectly adapted to whatever environment you put them in. So it's up to you to understand what it is that they are adapted for and to figure out how to recreate that. So as an example, these chanterelles on the left, you're not going to be able to recreate the environment that they need to grow in. But the lion's mane on the right, you can. So the first thing that mushrooms need is energy. Like animals, fungi are heterotrophs, meaning that they don't get their energy directly from sunlight. They have to ingest other organisms that have gotten energy either from sunlight or ingesting other organisms. So fungi can do this by decomposing dead things, by parasitizing living things, or by forming a relationship with plant roots that allows them to give plant roots things that the roots that the plant wants and get things in return that they want. Biological necessity number one, fungi need an energy source. For most of the gourmet mushrooms that are out there, that energy source is wood. All the stuff that we deal with are fungi that you would naturally find mushrooms growing on wood, on trees. So it's easy for a lot of those to recreate that at home just by finding the right species of wood, getting some fresh logs, inoculating them, and setting them out in the environment. People do that with shiitake logs quite successfully. And you can do that with a lot of other varieties too. But you may find that you want to be able to grow things year-round in a more controlled environment that's not dependent on having good weather. And you can do that by creating artificial logs using sawdust or straw or other plant matter in a bag or a bucket or something like that. So on the left, we've got shiitake log production. In the middle, we've got pretty typical production at a mushroom farm that's using sawdust fruiting blocks. And on the right is large bags with straw in them that are being used to grow mushrooms. Another thing that fungi need is air. Like animals, fungi can't produce oxygen the way plants can, so they've got to take in oxygen for cellular respiration. And in the process of cellular respiration, they give off carbon dioxide. With us, our main cue to breathe is carbon dioxide levels in the blood. So when the carbon dioxide in our blood starts getting high, our body tells us we need to breathe. Similarly with fungi, carbon dioxide levels around them tell them that they're not getting good fresh air, and they will do something to try to get better fresh air. So I really like this example. These two pictures on the left is commercially cultivated enoki that are grown in a high CO2 environment so that they get that desirable shape. Because it's a high CO2 environment, They grow long stems trying to get up to where the fresh air is. On the right is the wild version of those mushrooms that are just grown out in the real world where there's plenty of air around. So that's a case where the growers are actually manipulating them by keeping the airflow low to get an unnatural but desirable outcome. So biological necessity number two, they need plenty of fresh air to bring in oxygen, remove carbon dioxide. This is going to be important for you because of other things that we're going to be looking at that are going to limit airflow. Temperature. Like all living things, there is a temperature that they function best at. There are organisms that are adapted to live in the Arctic. There are organisms that are adapted to live in really hot desert climates. And if you were to look biologically at those different organisms, what you'd find is that the enzymes that make the chemical reactions work in those organisms are best suited to working at a certain temperature. And the same is true with different fungi. There are different temperature ranges that they work best at, that they'll grow best at, and they may only fruit under certain temperature conditions. So you need to be aware of what specific type of mushroom you're trying to grow, what its conditions that it's looking for are, so that you can mimic that. On the left here, Kathy's been out picking chanterelles in the middle of the summer. They love it hot. But on the right side, there's a hen of the wood, maitake, that's coming out in the fall. They come out when it starts cooling down and the temperatures at night start getting really cold. So we don't see them till September, October, even sometimes into November. Different ranges depending on the variety of mushrooms. So the third necessity, appropriate temperature range. You need to know the right range for your specific mushroom, and if you're trying to grow in a controlled environment, you're probably going to have to make some kind of separation around your growing area. It could be as simple as just setting up an area inside your house that's already controlled, but then creating an appropriate temperature in that space. But anytime you do that, anytime you close off an area, you're limiting airflow, and now you need to start thinking about biological necessity number two, which is how are you going to make sure they're getting enough fresh air. Next up is humidity. Fungi are very susceptible to drying out because they don't have skin that we have that keeps us from drying out. They don't have the cuticle that plants have that keep them from drying out. They are really dependent on, since they live inside of their food, really, they're dependent on moisture inside of the substrate they're living in. And then once they start sending mushrooms outside of that, they're really susceptible to those mushrooms that are outside of that moist environment really drying out. So for us to cultivate them successfully indoors, we want to create a humid environment for them to live in. So they need a high moisture substrate and a high humidity environment around that substrate. On this last picture, you can see these are pink oysters that are starting to grow out of an artificial log where we have a bag around supplemented sawdust. And that bag is acting like a skin to hold the moisture in. But once those mushrooms start pushing out, then it's going to be important for the humidity around that artificial log, that fruiting block, to be high so that the mushrooms don't dry out before they can mature. So best way to do this is with some form of a humidifier, and you can even set it up with a controller that senses the humidity level and turns it on and off as needed. But again, having that enclosed space where you're maintaining the humidity means that you're going to be limiting airflow. And so again, you need to consider how you're affecting airflow as you're doing that. other really important thing for you to know is that mushrooms are not the living organism. They are the fruit of the living organism. Just like an apple comes from an apple tree, the apple is the fruit of the apple tree. And if you want to successfully grow apples, then you've got to have an apple tree orchard. And you've got to take care of those apple trees and get them to a condition, create an environment where they are happy to produce those apples. Same deal with mushrooms. Those fruits, the mushrooms themselves, they are produced in order to reproduce. So with most mushrooms, the goal is to get them out into the open air. They'll produce spores, and then those spores will get carried by the wind to hopefully a suitable substrate so that they can grow further and reproduce. So you need to understand what the goal is of the mushroom itself, and understand that long before you get any mushrooms, you're going to be growing a fungus body, a mycelium, that will only fruit if it likes the conditions. So these pictures on the upper left, you can see the hyphae, the individual little fungus threads growing up the side of a bag from the growth substrate. On the lower picture on the left there, those shiitake logs have been inoculated in rows of holes. And you can see in that middle log, you can see there were five rows of holes down the length of that log where it was inoculated with the fungus. And that fungus then spread along the fibers of the log where it's easy to spread along the length of the log. And once it got to the end, they created these white spots you're seeing on the end of the log. They do the easy part first, traveling along those fibers. Once they get there and there's nowhere else to go, now they're going to start crossing over the fibers and they'll start filling in the space in between. And once they've filled up the space that they are in, then if the conditions are right, they will put out mushrooms in order to reproduce. And that's what you're seeing on the right. Those are shiitake mushrooms starting to form on a log. Another biological necessity is light. The fungus, before it fruits, doesn't need light. You imagine these are wood-loving mushrooms. They're growing in wood. And in the middle of that shiitake log you just saw, there's no light, and that's fine. But when they start fruiting, light is a really good indication of where fresh air is. So if there's a little bit of light coming to them from one area, that may be where they're going to want to push those mushrooms out to get to where they're getting into fresh air. So some amount of light is important. Some mushrooms, oyster mushrooms, won't produce caps without light. If you try to grow them in a dark environment, they're going to keep producing longer and longer stems, just like they will in a high carbon dioxide environment, because they're going to be trying to get to an area with better fresh air. So light's important. It doesn't have to be expensive light. You really don't need full spectrum lighting. You only need the blue end of the spectrum. So if you find LED lights that say they're cool or cold, as opposed to a warm light that's sort of yellow, you want the bluish end, that's what you're looking for. So to review, you need to think about an appropriate energy source, getting fresh air to your mushrooms, the appropriate temperature range for what you're trying to grow, high moisture substrate with a high humidity environment around it, and some kind of a light source. Those are the important things that your mushrooms are going to need for you to be successful. And in our next video, we'll be showing you how to set up a simple and very affordable growing environment that'll let you accomplish all of these goals. So that'll be up next time. In the meantime, I'm Ernie from Borrowed Land Farm. You can find us at borrowedlandfarm.com. And again, we've got spawn available and commercial fruiting blocks for farms that are looking to get commercial fruiting blocks to grow out. All right, thank you, and we'll see you next time.